Good evening and welcome to this first edition of The Checkpoint right here at Urban. I am Nicholas Wasaja, your host. The Centers for Disease Control and Prevention is one of the major operating components of the Department of Health and Human Services in the United States of America. The institution protects America's health, safety, and security threats both at home and abroad. At the core of its mandate is research aimed at fighting disease and support communities to do the same. CDC started its work in Uganda in 1991 and established its office in 2000 with focus on prevention, control, and treatment. The agency has treated tens of thousands of people living with HIV and AIDS and responded to over 35 outbreaks in Uganda. CDC has maintained a polio-free status and helped us deal with malaria, TB, as well as other health concerns. Now, in the wake of the coronavirus disease, it is only prudent that we talk to CDC and its work in Uganda. My guest tonight is none other than the CDC Country Director, Dr. Lisa Nelson. Dr. Lisa joined CDC in Uganda in 2017, tagging along with a wealth of experience in public health. Interestingly, Dr. Lisa is both a political and health scientist. She holds a degree in political science from Yale University and a medical degree from the University of California. She has also studied epidemiology and health sciences at master's level from the University of California. Dr. Lisa is a pediatric infectious disease fellow from Boston. A mother of three, Dr. Lisa also speaks French, Portuguese, and Spanish. She enjoys traveling and outdoor activities with family. Dr. Lisa, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Tonight, we are going to discuss COVID-19 in charge of finding a remedy. And my belief is that CDC is at the center of this pandemic. So, but before we go into the ramifications of COVID-19, as CDC, what exactly is your contribution to global health security?
Sure. As you've laid out, Nicholas, the CDC is a public health agency of the United States government. We're part of the Department of Health and Human Services, which is like the Ministry of Health in the United States. But since its inception, CDC has also worked on global health. We provide technical expertise to multilateral organizations, and we also have over 44 country offices in countries like Uganda, where we work in partnership with the host government, Ministry of Health, with other partners and with others on the ground to provide technical support and financial assistance for public health programs and for diseases of public health importance like HIV, TB, malaria, and now COVID-19.
Do you have any collaboration with governments in third world countries to build capacity in detecting and preventing infectious diseases?
Yes, we do. First and foremost, we work on the core building blocks of a public health response. So that's the workforce, training epidemiologists and other public health professionals, laboratory systems. So that's building capacity in countries like Uganda to detect diseases like Ebola, like HIV, et cetera, working on public health research, and also more recently supporting emergency operations. So Uganda has an emergency operations center. One of the things we do is provide support and training for that emergency operations center to function.
But COVID-19 has dismantled the entire global health system, and it seems like it has brought it to its knees. Mm. Is this because you people in charge of epidemiology slept on the job, or it's just a question of being overwhelmed?
Sure. I think the COVID-19 outbreak, which began in late December, the first notification to the World Health Organization was on December 31st, has really been unprecedented. It's probably the biggest outbreak since the influenza pandemic of 1918. So in that sense, it has really overwhelmed many countries' abilities to diagnose and treat this disease. But I think as a global public health community, we have been aware for some time that viruses like SARS, like MERS, like different kinds of influenza viruses can cause worldwide pandemics. And really, since about 2013, the world has been working on what we call the global health security agenda. And Uganda has actually been a leader in that effort to prevent, detect, and respond to global disease outbreaks. So while this particular virus is unprecedented in its scope, I think the world has been anticipating something like this and working to prepare.
You've talked of SARS, but people interchangeably use coronavirus and COVID-19. Probably, could you help us educate us on the difference between any other coronavirus and then in particular COVID-19?
Sure. So there is a family of viruses called coronaviruses, corona meaning crown, that are related. And we know that some of the emerging infections in recent years, like SARS and MERS, are part of this coronavirus family. This particular virus, which we identified in early January and WHO has named COVID-19, is also called the SARS-CoV-2 virus. So it's part of that family of viruses.
My understanding is that you've been working closely with the Ministry of Health and the Ugandan government. But on a scale of 1 to 10, how would you rate Uganda's response in relation to COVID-19?
I think, quite honestly, Uganda has been doing really well. I'd say maybe 7, 8, depending on how you want to look at it. I think no country was entirely ready for this virus. And I think, you know, one of the things we've talked about is efforts to flatten the curve so that if and when Uganda gets more infections, they don't all come at the same time. So there's certainly things Uganda needs to keep doing. But the fact that investments from organizations like CDC and other US government agencies to build laboratory systems, to train public health professionals, to invest in data systems, meant that Uganda was better prepared than other countries. And the other thing, the other reason I would give Uganda high marks is that many of the measures were put in place even before we identified the first case here, and that is information to the community about how they can prevent infection, stay home if they're sick, wash their hands, practice social distancing, screening at the airports, more recently screening at the border posts, closing down nationwide. All of those things were done relatively early in Uganda, even compared with some of her neighbors.
Managing diagnosis and reporting cases for possible treatment of infectious diseases is one of the challenges that we face in third world countries, especially given the issue of access to facilities. How does CDC support these efforts?
Sure, so I think the laboratory system is extremely important. We'd ideally like to diagnose each and every case of COVID-19. We've seen even in countries in Europe and the United States, when you have a large number of cases, it's not always possible to diagnose each and every case. But having a system where the right diagnosis can be made, so you know who is infected, and then you can do contact tracing around that to identify who that person has come into contact with, get that person into quarantine, and test those contacts is important. And over the last two or three decades, CDC has supported Uganda to build really a very high quality laboratory network. A lot of that was based on funding for HIV, but Uganda has over 100 hubs around the country that serve as points of collection of specimens that can then be sent to Uganda Virus Research Institute for testing, and those results can be returned to clinicians who are treating those patients.
How can Uganda be supported to do the most important mass testing as a way of dealing with the dangers of especially asymptomatic cases?
Sure. So all countries right now are really working towards testing as many people as possible. So we're fortunate in Uganda that that there are many machines, the platforms where the laboratory testing can be done, and many laboratorians that have been trained to do that test. Right now, testing is centralized at Uganda Virus Research Institute, but efforts are underway to bring some of these other labs where the machines are available, the trained personnel are available, to be able to do the tests once we have reagents. I think the other thing is this is a very dynamic environment, and new tests are coming on board every day. So what we'd ideally like to be able to do is have point of care tests, like a pregnancy test where results would be available in 20 or 30 minutes, and we'd have high quality, accurate results. Right now, there aren't that many tests on the market that are available, and countries like Uganda are having trouble getting enough of those in. But I think in the near future, the goal would be to decentralize testing as much as possible, and where we can use high quality, rapid diagnostic tests at the borders, at other points of entries, we would work towards doing that. I think because this is a new virus and because the science is evolving very quickly, I'm hopeful that in the next couple months we'll have even more ability to test more people.
Scientists have urge people to wash hands and use sanitizers as a way of killing this virus. Help me reconcile. How is it possible that we can detect that use of soap and water and hand sanitizers is available, but there is no knowledge on a cure in place?
Sure. So any respiratory virus like coronavirus, the measures that are needed are sort of social distancing first and foremost. So if people are sick, they should stay home. If they're coughing, they should cover their cough. Frequent hand washing. So if you touch a surface that's been contaminated, you clean your hands. You avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth, and that sort of thing. So those kinds of things are known. I think the reality is that this is a new virus. And so we are learning all the time. You may know, and I think many people are anxious to hear about developments for vaccines and treatments for this virus. And I think many researchers around the world are working together to identify candidate vaccines, to test them in animals and then in humans and clinical trials, and to do the same with therapeutic agents. But again, we didn't know this virus was out there until late December. So we're only now in April. That hasn't given scientists very much time to develop treatment options and vaccines.
So what exactly has aided the spread of the virus? You could help us answer some myths that how does it respond to cold or hot temperatures?
Sure. So like many respiratory viruses, it's passed from somebody who is coughing or talking when those droplets either are in the air and breathed in by somebody, but more likely when someone touches a contaminated surface. So I think that, the second part of your question was about the role of climate. So a lot of experience with influenza viruses, and in colder climates, we typically see in the United States, for instance, we see an increase in cases in the fall, in October, November, and generally by April, we start to see a decline. And any given year, depending on the strain of influenza, depending on how well that particular vaccine is working that year, we may see more or fewer cases. We have less data from more warmer climates or more temperate climates like Uganda. We do know there's influenza here. We also know that it has some seasonality to it. I think early on, people had thought that perhaps this virus would go away in April. That's sort of what happened with the SARS virus in 2003, was that when the weather warmed up, we saw fewer cases. Unfortunately, with this virus, we're really not seeing that. We see in many countries case counts are continuing to go up, and there's plenty of countries in Africa, almost every country that has reported cases. The virus got here a little bit later than it did in Europe or in the United States, but it doesn't seem that this virus minds a warm climate, unfortunately.
Can a person's immune system help them fight the virus?
Absolutely. So of the more than 3 million confirmed cases, we've seen many hundreds of thousands of people recover from this virus. So the good news is that young people in particular, some of them have no symptoms, or if they have symptoms, they have very mild symptoms, so their body is fighting off this infection. Unfortunately, we know that people who are older, people who may have pre-existing health conditions, may have a harder time fighting off this virus. But absolutely, most normal, healthy people, their body will fight off this virus.
Doctor, there have been conspiracy theories that this virus is actually man-made. Is this really true?
We have no evidence of that. I will say that, again, it's a new virus. We're learning things all the time. We do also know that new viruses or novel infections often come from animal reservoirs. So in the case of Marburg virus, for instance, we know it comes from bats. In the case of Ebola, we suspect it comes from bats, but we've had difficulty exactly finding the same strain in bats as we find in humans. And so it's possible as a novel coronavirus that this virus came from an animal reservoir, but I think a lot of research is still underway to determine where the virus came from.
But are there actually man-made viruses apart from COVID?
I think people can do a lot of different things in the lab, but I also would caution that there's a lot of misinformation out there. So as far as I know, researchers are still trying to determine exactly where this virus came from.
Okay, so CDC through PEPFAR has been supporting initiatives around TB, malaria, and HIV. However, this, like many other initiatives, has been affected by COVID-19. Should we expect continued support now that COVID has dismantled economies all over the world, including the US?
Yeah, so as you rightly pointed out, the US government and CDC is one of the agencies that is heavily involved, has invested in many different health initiatives here in Uganda. The President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, or PEPFAR, the President's Malaria Initiative, PMI, and this has allowed us to fund many different activities in Uganda related to particularly HIV, malaria, tuberculosis, but more recently, the global health security agenda. I think the good news is that the funding for those initiatives has continued from our Congress and from the American people. And then more recently, there is money being set aside to address COVID-19 globally. But we have money for the next year secured for the PEPFAR program, for the malaria program, so we anticipate that those programs will continue.
There's been a strong gut feeling within sections of people that, is it really possible that with all the technology that is available in the world, we could really fail to find a cure or a vaccine as immediately as possible to curb the spread?
Yeah, well, I'm optimistic that a vaccine will be developed. So I heard the other day from the head of Uganda Virus Research Institute that there are six vaccines that are in phase one clinical trials. I also read in the paper the other day that Oxford University has really the lead on some of the most promising vaccines. So I think there are probably dozens of vaccines in the pipeline that are under development. I think the challenge is it takes time. Number one, vaccine, and then we have to document the efficacy, that it actually works in humans, and it just takes time to do those kinds of clinical trials. But I will say we have some of our biggest disease threats in places like Uganda, HIV, TB, malaria. We've really failed to develop effective vaccines. Now, those are different pathogens, but you know, it's possible that it will take longer than we would like to find a vaccine for this.
You previously talked of Uganda's efforts to start clinical trials and all that, but there are some reports that are indicating that Africa is actually not generating enough essential data to support vital tracking on how the virus mutates as it spreads for development of diagnostic tests and a possible vaccine. Please speak to this.
Sure. So I think one of the things that's been really remarkable about this outbreak is how much international scientific collaboration there has been. Literally dozens of new scientific publications every day from all around the world. The genome was shared with the scientific community very early on so that people could begin to work on diagnostic tests and therapeutic agents and vaccines. So Uganda's an important part of that. As far as we know so far, the virus that we have here is the same virus that everybody else has. But I think it is important that Uganda continue to participate in global scientific efforts. There are many very well-trained and highly regarded Ugandan scientists. And as you may know, there is a scientific advisory committee that's providing recommendations to the Ministry of Health and to the government of Uganda. And I think many of those people are involved already in scientific collaborations with our National Institute of Health in the United States, with research institutions in the UK. So I do believe that as and when vaccine studies get underway, that Uganda may be able to participate and even lead in certain aspects of important research.
But in terms of research, probably you could be in the know. How has Uganda progressed in trying to find a possible vaccine and treatment?
Sure. Well, I think Uganda Virus Research Institute is part of many vaccine studies, HIV vaccine studies, Ebola vaccine studies, and they may very well be, as we speak, engaged in vaccine studies related to COVID-19. I'd have to check with my colleagues at UVRI. I think the other thing that I wanted to say is that Uganda is part, the World Health Organization has several multi-country studies that they have put forward. One is called the Solidarity Study that's looking at treatment options, and Uganda has submitted this proposal here to be part of this multi-country study to look at different treatment options.
Some reports have indicated that Africa is the next epicenter for the virus. What can be done to be ahead of this kind of situation?
Sure. So what is true is that we see case counts rising in many African countries. As I said, some of that's a function of time, that, you know, the virus started in Asia, it spread to Europe, it spread to the United States, and it began coming into Africa from people traveling a bit later. So I certainly don't think we're out of the woods yet. I think all of the things that Uganda has been doing will help. So first and foremost, taking responsibility at the individual level to reduce your risk. If you're sick, you stay home. If you're coughing, you cover your cough. If you, as much as possible, practice the social distancing, washing your hands, all of those things that will protect you from getting coronavirus, but quite honestly will protect you from getting other viruses that are circulating in the community. At the public health level, Uganda has been doing a lot. Certainly, as we know, screening travelers early on, putting out messages to the community, more recently screening truck drivers who are coming into the country, and collecting data. And I think the Emergency Operations Center has a situation room now that's operating 24 hours a day, looking at data, looking at where new positives are coming in and how the contact tracing efforts are going, looking at all of the different systems we've been putting in place to do the laboratory testing, to do the border screening, to do other kinds of monitoring. So, you know, I think Uganda has really done a lot of what we would want to see happen to prevent this disease from coming to Uganda, and when it arrives, to contain it very quickly.
Doctor, some scientists have suggested that Africans should be the guinea pigs for testing, making trials for a vaccine. What is your take on these kind of comments?
Sure. Well, I don't think anybody should be a guinea pig for scientific. You know, really, the way we've been approaching this virus has been scientific collaboration across the globe, and I think As I mentioned, there are many Ugandan scientists who already have collaborations with academic and research institutions in the United States, in Europe, and around the world. So I'm hopeful that Uganda could participate. But as with any research, there's an ethical review process that has to take place, and participants have to consent. And that should happen here just as it should happen anywhere.
Media has recently been awash with stories that President Donald Trump actually suggested that patients should be injected with disinfectants. From a scientific point of view, is this really feasible?
Yeah, I think what he said was really confusing. I think it's important to recognize that when we say disinfectants, usually we mean things that we're using that are alcohol-based to clean surfaces or to wash our hands. And so certainly we need to follow the science, but many of those compounds are quite toxic and would not be appropriate to put them in high concentrations in human beings.
Risk communication is usually dependent on accurate messaging. Comment on Uganda's COVID-19 messaging.
Yeah, so I think, starting with Minister Acheng and leadership within the government of Uganda, your president and others in the Ministry of Health, they have been very active holding different types of media events. The president has addressed Ugandans many times. I think all of that's really important. I think one of the things the World Health Organization has been starting to advise countries on what they should consider to begin to lift the lockdown, and that is certainly something that Uganda has considered. And an important aspect of that is risk communication right down to community level. So, you know, it's important that the leadership of countries like Uganda talk about this virus, that scientific experts talk about this virus, that people talk about this virus in their households. But these messages have to get down to community level. So I think a lot of the effort more recently has been developing messages in local languages that can be shared, working with local radio stations in communities, and even providing megaphones so that this kind of communication gets really right down to community level. Because at the end of the day, we're asking people to change their behavior, and it's likely that's going to need to take place for quite a long period of time. And for people to really practice behavior change, it starts with an understanding of why that's important.
Doctor, the question of stigma is one of the challenges that is actually baffling health workers and caregivers. How do you think this could be handled?
Sure. So I think it's understandable. This is a new virus. People are afraid. And sometimes fear causes people to shun other people with the disease, or to take flight, or to take action that isn't all that helpful in a public health response. So I think the more we can educate the public, we can educate people with the disease, contacts of the disease. It's reassuring, as I said, that a large percentage of people who get this virus will actually have few or very mild symptoms. And most people will recover. Obviously, we want to prevent as many people from becoming infected as possible, but I think it's important to recognize that many people will recover from this virus, that we know that there are ways to prevent us from getting it, and to trace the contacts of people who've been exposed. So I think part of how we combat stigma is to make sure that people are armed with the right information, and that people in leadership positions, health workers, the media, and others are promoting correct information. With social media, unfortunately, we sometimes see the propagation of a lot of misinformation. So I think all of us have an important responsibility in making sure that correct information is shared.
The CDC has done tremendous work in developing Uganda's capacity in testing, research, and surveillance of epidemics, which has helped us which has helped us respond to this pandemic more positively. However, this capacity appears to be largely centralized. What is CDC doing for local and upcountry health facilities to ensure that its work is a bit more decentralized?
Sure. So yes, not surprisingly, you know, our office is based here and a lot of our activities are based here. But in fact, many of our efforts really do cut across all of Uganda. So laboratory systems, we've talked about the fact that also that we've trained a lot of laboratorians and accredited actually at the international level quite a number of labs. I visited Chiriondongo about 2 years ago, which was the first public lab that was accredited in Uganda. So laboratory systems, we've definitely decentralized. One other key component are data systems. And so we have worked to train village health teams to suspect cases of concerning diseases like Ebola and like plague and report those and support reporting using smartphones and integrated disease surveillance systems that go right down to the village level. I think the last example that I would give is the public health workforce. So yes, many people have been trained here in Kampala, but we also have a frontline program that trains epidemiologists and public health professionals in all the districts in Uganda, again, to recognize diseases of public health importance, to report them and to respond.
President Yoweri Museveni's last interview with the media, he expressed optimism that we are progressing in trying to bring down the curve. When we come back from the break, we shall start from there.
Okay, thank you.